Hi everyone and welcome to OGLDEV. My name is Etay Meiri. In the previous video we learned how to open a window for graphics using FreeGLAT, and today we're going to put our first dot on the screen. Now I have a big disclaimer here. This video and the next one may not work on all systems because we're still not using shaders. If they don't work for you, simply hang on until we get to tutorial number 4 and I think everything will be okay by then. The main challenge for beginners with OpenGL is that you need to do quite a lot of setup in order to get that first primitive on the screen. And the primitive can be point or line or triangle. This long setup is the result of the GPU being composed of a pipeline of stages where each stage requires its own preparation. Now in 3D, I like to make progress in very small steps, so I created this tutorial without enabling any shaders whatsoever. It works okay on my NVIDIA GPU, so it may work on other systems as well. Perhaps NVIDIA have some defaults in place that enable this tutorial to work. I'm not exactly sure. If you're not familiar with shaders, they are programs that you write that are executed by the GPU on every vertex or primitive or a pixel. Think about the difference between a GUI versus something that you write in programming language. In a GUI, you are limited to what the GUI can do, but in a programming language, you can write just about anything. Before we jump into the code, I'd like to say something about the GLEW library or GLEW. You remember that in the previous video, I promised that I will say something about it. So as a library, OpenGL works a bit differently than other libraries. Usually, libraries provide you with function pointers that you must include, and you have their definition in the libraries that you need to link against. OpenGL was developed by a consortium of companies called Cronus, and in order to allow each company to innovate independently, they created a concept of extensions, where each company can publish a draft of an extension that enables new functionality on its GPUs. Now this extension undergoes a system of peer review by Cronus, and so its status can be upgraded from a draft to official to even get into the OpenGL core. This means that on different GPUs or even a different revision of the same GPU, you may get different functionality. It all depends on the number of extensions that are available on your system. To handle all this complexity, the OpenGL designers have decided to expose OpenGL as a set of function pointers rather than regular functions. So in order to use a function, you must first search for its pointer and then call that function through that pointer. You can do that, obviously, but the recommended way to work is using an OpenGL loading library that abstracts all this. The library searches the system for all the extensions that are available, it queries the function pointers, and it arranges them in a way that exposes them to you using regular functions. GLEW is such a library, a loading OpenGL loading library, and this is what we're using. As I said, we are going to make some shortcuts on our way to get the first point on the screen. Let's see how we can accomplish that. What we have here is a diagram of the OpenGL pipeline. This is the first page in the latest OpenGL spec, version 4.6. I'll put a link to that in the video description. In many GPUs, you will actually see hardware components that correspond to the elements that you see in the diagram. Our job as OpenGL programmers is to configure this complex beast, feed it with data, and hopefully, if we have done everything correctly, we will get the expected result on the screen. For now, try to ignore most of what you see here and just focus on the rasterizer here. The job of the rasterizer is to receive the vertices of a basic OpenGL primitive, such as a point or a line or a triangle, and map them to physical pixels on the screen. In the most complex case, the triangle, the rasterizer needs to find out all the pixels that are enclosed within that triangle. In the case of a line, the rasterizer needs to find all the pixels that the imaginary geometric line between the two vertices passes through. The point is the simplest case because it usually maps to a single pixel. There is support for points that are larger than one pixel, but let's ignore that for now. You may have heard about coordinate spaces and transformation matrices that are involved in the procedure of rendering a 3D image onto a 2D window, and it's all true. But for now, we can simply ignore it. You only need to think about the rasterizer as a machine that gets vectors as input and maps them to pixels. If we provide it with the correct input, we will get some output on the screen. So what is the correct input? Take a look at the next image. Here we can see the logical representation of the rasterizer input. The rasterizer receives a two-dimensional vector where both components are in the range of -1 to 1. There is actually a third coordinate for the depth, but I'm ignoring it for now. You can see that the input range creates a square and not a rectangle, which is your screen. In a real application, we will need to take care of this square to rectangle mapping, but for now, we don't really care. The bottom left-hand corner is mapped to -1 by -1, and it goes all the way up to the upper right-hand corner where we have 1 by 1. It's very easy to see that 0 by 0 is mapped to the center of the screen. So all we need to do is provide input within that range and we should get some visual feedback. Because we don't have any shaders in previous stages of the pipeline, they are basically functioning as pass-through components, so they don't modify our input. As I said in the introduction, this is a bit hacky and may not work everywhere. If my original code doesn't work for you and you find a way to make it work, please share this knowledge. Now that we understand what type of input we need to provide, let's see how we can get it into the rasterizer. We begin by initializing GLUT and creating a window. Next, we see the call to GLUE init in order to initialize GLUE. It is very important to do this after GLUT has been initialized because we need the OpenGL context that GLUT creates. Here I'm simply following on the example from the GLUE webpage, which we can see right here. It is also recommended to check the return value of GLUE init and print the error as a string using GLUE get error string in case something went wrong. We continue as usual with the initialization of the clear color, the setting of the display callback function, and the call to GLUT main loop. What is new here is the call to create vertex buffer, which is a local function that performs the initialization of the vertex buffer. The vertex buffer contains the coordinates of that single dot that we plan to display. First, we create an array of the vector3f struct with the size of 1. Vector3f represents a vector with 3 floating points and is declared in the oglDEV_math_3d.h header, which is located in the include directory. Let's take a quick look at it. We can see that it is a very simple structure with 3 floating point elements named x, y, and z. We are initializing it using the first constructor right here. There's more stuff here which we will need in the future, but we don't care about it right now. So we initialize the single vector in the array with zeros in all components, as we discussed earlier. Remember that we can ignore the third component for now. Next, we create a handle for our vertex buffer object. This is one of several object types that are defined by the OpenGL specification. There are also texture objects, frame buffer objects, and a few others. Each object type represents a state that is relevant for that type. For example, a vertex buffer object provides access to the vertex buffer data in the memory of the GPU. Each object type is associated with a range of positive unsigned integers called a namespace. The lifecycle of an object begins by reserving or allocating an unused handle in the namespace. At this point, there is still no concrete object of that type that is associated with the handle. To do that, we usually need to bind the handle to a target. Each object type can have multiple targets, and only when a handle is bound to a target, the system knows what type of object to allocate. So for example, we can create a handle for a buffer object, but only at bind time the system will know whether this is a vertex buffer or an index buffer. Vertex buffers contains actual vertex data, and index buffers contains indices that point to locations in vertex buffers. Once an object handler has been bound to a target, we can load it with data and use it for the actual rendering. When we no longer need the object instance, we can deallocate the handle, which ends the object lifecycle. Allocating a handle for a buffer object is done by calling glgenBuffers. This function takes two arguments. The first one is the number of handles that we want to allocate, and the second is a pointer to an array of GLU int elements which must be big enough to contain that number of handles. Here we can see that we are allocating a single handle, and this handle goes into the VBO variable, which is defined in the global namespace of the file, right here. Once the handle has been allocated, we bind it to the array buffer target. This tells the OpenGL driver that we plan to populate it with vertex attributes. These can be position coordinates, texture coordinates, colors, etc. For now, we only need position. The next function call, glBufferData, actually loads the position of our vertex into the vertex buffer object. Notice that the first parameter is glArrayBuffer, which is the target to which the handle was bounded. The handle itself is not referenced here at all. OpenGL knows which handle is currently bound to the glArrayBuffer target, so it will direct the vertex data to it. The second parameter is the size in bytes of the buffer. And the third parameter is the pointer to the buffer itself. The last parameter is a performance hit to the driver. It tells the driver what is our intent for this buffer. Are we going to read from it, to draw from it, to copy to another buffer, etc. This allows the driver to prepare itself to optimize the operation on this buffer. We don't know whether this will indeed happen, and it may change between GPUs and driver revisions, so you will simply need to experiment it yourself. Here we are using glStaticDraw, which means that we will populate the buffer once and use it for drawing multiple times. With our vertex buffer object complete, let's review the last set of changes, which is in the render callback function. Here we start as usual with the clearing of the callo buffer, which is basically the window. Next, we bind the vertex buffer object to the glArrayBuffer target. This tells OpenGL that we are going to use it. This seems a bit redundant because we know that this handle is still bound to the same target. But in a real-world application, you may have many buffer objects handles, and unless you keep track of the last handle bound to a target, it is safer to bind the handle before using it. The next thing we do is to call glEnableVertexAttributeArray in order to enable vertex attribute 0. A vertex attribute can be its position, texture coordinate, color, as well as user-defined attributes. Each attribute is associated with an index, so in order to use that attribute, we must enable that index. Think of it as a gate that must be open in order for the data to flow in. Here we have a single vertex attribute, the position, so we enable index 0. Next, we call glVertexAttributeArray to specify the format of the vertex attribute. Remember that we loaded three floating point elements into the buffer, but we never told OpenGL how to interpret them. Are these floating points or integers? Are these three independent elements, or do they belong to a single three-dimensional vector? This function call takes care of all that. The first parameter is the attribute index, 0 in our case. The second parameter is the number of elements in this attribute, so we have 3 for a three-dimensional vector. The next parameter is the type of each element, so we specify floating point. The fourth parameter is somewhat strange. It tells OpenGL whether to normalize the data to the 0 to 1 or minus 1 to 1 range. If I need normalized data, I would do it myself before loading it, so I usually put false here. The fifth parameter is the stride. This means the number of bytes to the next occurrence of this attribute in a buffer. The type of the last parameter is a pointer, but it is actually treated as an integer. This is the offset in bytes from the beginning of the buffer to the location of the first instance of this attribute. We use it when we pack different attributes into the same buffer. Let's see an example that demonstrates the last two parameters, the stride and the offset. Here we have a vertex with three attributes, position, texture coordinates, and color, that are packed into the same buffer. Assume all of them are floating points. Position and color have three elements, and texture coordinates have two. So position is located at offset 0, texture coordinates are at 3 times 4 bytes per floating point, so that's 12, and we add another 8 bytes for the texture coordinates to find the color at offset 20. These three attributes represent a single vertex. If the next vertex in the buffer is tightly packed to this vertex, that is to say, there are no gaps between the two vertices, then the stride for each attribute would be 20 bytes. When we have a single attribute in a buffer which is tightly packed, we use stride 0. Since our position vector starts at the beginning of the buffer, we also have 0 as the offset. Finally, we tell OpenGL to render using our vertex buffer object as input. We do this using GLDrawArrays. Consider this function as a trigger that launches a massive series of operations. The driver tells the GPU to start reading from the bound buffer and pass the data through the pipeline. The vertex data passes through the shading units and remains untouched since we don't have shaders enabled, and reaches the rasterizer. The rasterizer checks if the vertex position is within the visible part of the screen according to the diagram that we saw. If it is, it maps it to the corresponding pixel. GLDrawArrays takes three parameters. The first one tells OpenGL how to interpret the data in terms of primitive type. Here we are telling it to treat the data as points. Each point is made of a single vertex, so our vertex should be okay. The second parameter is the index of our first vertex to draw. For example, we can load 1,000 vertices into a buffer and start at vertex 500. We want to start from the first vertex, so we specify 0. The last parameter is the number of vertices to process. Again, this allows us to process a partial buffer. After calling GLDrawArrays, we disable the vertex attribute 0. Enabling and disabling the same attribute index seems a bit silly here, but I wanted to show you how to keep the OpenGL runtime state clean. Maintaining the correct state in a real application is critical in order to avoid strange bugs. The last thing here is to tell GLUT to swap the front and back buffers as usual. Now let's take a look at the include files. We have two new includes here, glue.h for glue, and OGLDEV_math3d.h for the vector3d structure. Notice that glue.h is included before freeglut.h. Look what happens when we reverse the order. When we build the source file, we get these strange build errors. This is yet another order dependency peculiarity of glue, so make sure you get this right to avoid wasting time on Stack Overflow trying to resolve this. Let's reverse it back and run it. And we can see our single dot here in the middle. Let's also take a look at the changes in the build.sh script. There is actually a single change here. I've added CPP flags which add the OGLDEV include directory into the include search path. This allows us to include that math header by just specifying its name. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it and found it useful. Let me know what you think in the comments below. In the next video, we will turn our dot into a full triangle. Triangles are the core building blocks in OpenGL, in 3D in general, so they are very important. So I hope to see you soon.